Man, I feel kind of hungry. I think I need to eat something. Whew, feeling pretty full. I think I'm done with this. I'll save the rest. I think I'm gonna get a snack. The quest to become an intuitive eater, a short story by Stephanie Buttermore. But seriously, this has been a long and arduous process, but was ultimately the goal out of everything that I've done in my dieting slash all in saga, which happily brings me to today. Which, by the way, is May 1st, 2021, and I went all in May 27th, 2019, which kind of blows my mind. Now, I am by no means a model of intuitive eating perfection, but I am leaps and bounds better with being in touch with my satiety cues, honoring my hunger, my relationship with food,
Yum.
And just like overall eating behavior than I've been since competing in 2014. Really quick, in case you're unfamiliar, I do want to go through like a super brief history to remind you of how I got here. And then I'll talk about my own transition into intuitive eating, as well as tips from me and experts in intuitive eating towards the end.
Having me on to chat.
So to start, before I went all in, I had absolutely no sense of being full.
Are you full?
Never.
And was not in touch whatsoever with my hunger and satiety cues.
It's like broccoli.
Actually, let me take that back. I was in tune with my hunger cues because they were always turned on, but it was the satiety cues that were non-existent.
Is it bad that I want another bowl?
Meaning, I could eat for what felt like forever and never get full.
Do I want another one?
Oh my God.
Should I kill this box?
No satiety cues or fullness for me. So, like the obedient, physique conscious fitness gal I was always disciplined with my diet, and I would usually stop around the 60% full mark, thinking like, okay, Stephanie, you've had enough. At least what I thought was enough, but was never fully satisfied. In retrospect, I know now that this was my body's way of telling me that I was too lean and I needed to eat more, but my stubborn, high volume, clean eating fitness brain just didn't want to hear it because the amount of calories I was eating seemed to be reasonable at the time. And I felt that pressure to look a certain way for social media. It's so dumb, I know. But I would balance out my clean eating by being a flexible dieter, and of course, the occasional cheat day. But it was just not enough, and my body always wanted more. And always being hungry was just miserable and a sad way to live. I was over it. So I went all in.
I want to be able to eat as many calories as I need to feel full.
Most of you guys will know the story from there. So now I want to talk about how I transitioned from my all-in diet, which was eating thousands and thousands of calories, into currently eating intuitively, which is a way more balanced diet that is satisfying while still honoring my hunger, which almost 2 years after starting my journey, no longer requires me to eat every second of every day. So first and foremost, I gotta talk about what intuitive eating is and what it isn't, just so we're all on the same page. Intuitive eating is not a fancy new diet like keto, paleo, or the carnivore diet. And it's not time specific like intermittent fasting. It's not at all a weight loss tactic. It's most common that people just maintain their weight eating intuitively, but people can lose weight doing it and people can also gain weight. Honestly, it just depends on the person. I just want to be super clear that the goal isn't to change your body eating this way. So not a fad or a new trend. It actually very much so goes hand in hand with body acceptance. You eat to satisfy your health and hunger, not to manipulate your weight.
Heartbreak is so good.
It's actually a pretty simple concept that might remind you of a simpler time in your life. I got a comment on my Instagram that was hilarious to me. She said something along the lines of, if diet culture wasn't so toxic, intuitive eating would just be called eating because that's all it really is. It basically reminds me of when I was a kid and into my teens. I ate 3 meals a day with snacks and just ate because I was hungry. And I ate food that I wanted to. Some of it was very nutritious and some of it probably wasn't. And when I think back to that time, I would consider my eating behavior pretty normal. Well, normal for growing up in the 90s. And that's mentally what I feel like intuitive eating is, in an anecdotal sense, with a bit more nuance, like being mindful while eating and paying attention to feelings of hunger and fullness. But I also want to give you a proper scientific definition so you understand fully. So intuitive eating is characterized by having a strong connection with and eating in accordance to physiological hunger and satiety cues, rather than on like emotional or external cues, and recognizing that all foods serve a variety of purposes, like taste and fueling your body. It's also characterized by giving yourself an unconditional permission to eat, honoring your hunger, and respecting the body regardless of weight and shape, and being physically active for enjoyment and for health, not just for burning calories or losing weight. If you want more science on the topic, there's actually a ton of research on it, and I've listed a lot of really good papers in the description box below. However, in general, intuitive eating is often associated with a better relationship with food, better body image, and less disordered eating.
Right, so good.
Which all sounds great to me, and was ultimately my end goal for my all-in journey. I didn't go all in to eat 5,000 calories every day forever. It was to give myself permission to eat as much as I wanted in hopes that once I fixed my extreme hunger, this whatever I wanted would be a balanced and non-restrictive diet. It took time, but eventually over the course of the past almost 2 years now, continuously giving myself unconditional permission to eat, the amount I needed to feel full just naturally decreased over time. I didn't even have to do anything special other than just eat when I was hungry. I mean, it's pretty basic stuff. So just to get into some of the smaller details of the transition of my own eating journey, as you may know, I started out eating about 5,000 calories a day.
Okay, so this is what I had for breakfast. I had 2 large bananas, I had 2 packets of oatmeal, I had an apple, and then I had 4 sweet potatoes, and I had 2 scoops of protein. Nice. Is that normal?
For the first 2-ish months, basically eating like every second of every day. And that eventually went down to about 4,000 calories for a few months, and I was eating spaced out meals like 3 to 4 times a day, which then trickled down to about 3,000 calories a day, still eating spaced out meals and snacks. And I think I was eating 3,000 calories a day for a while. I would say at least 6 months before my appetite slowly crawled down to about maybe 2,800 calories. I mean, I'm sure there are days that I still hit 3,000, but that's about where I am right now. And it's so funny because at the beginning, my meals would be a smorgasbord of mac and cheese, Oreos, sweet potatoes, and avocado toast. So after that honeymoon phase, I eventually had a good balance of protein, carbs, and fat without being too perfect about it or anything. Like, I was just trying to do my best while still accommodating my extreme hunger. Not long after I started eating meals that were balanced and satisfying, low-key stopped eating like a 5-year-old assembling their lunchbox, I started having a strong sense of my hunger and satiety cues. So I would know when to eat and I would know when to stop. But like I said, this took time, and I could feel this sense of satiety come in slowly, and I knew it was happening, so I was very patient with myself. And after about a year, the strangest thing happened, and I swung too far to the proverbial other side, and I actually experienced a few months of struggling with a low appetite.
I have absolutely no desire to eat.
The irony of all of it was not lost on me. This was a few months back, and if you're curious, my appetite is so much better now, especially after implementing a few strategies like eating earlier in the day and just like eating higher calorie foods. So my appetite is great, and all of this brings us full circle to today. But since I'm still in the process of learning to navigate this way of eating, I did want to bring on an expert on the topic.
Hello, how are you?
So I talked to nutrition therapist and certified intuitive eating counselor, Alissa Rumsey, author of Unapologetic Eating, to weigh in on this.
The way I think about intuitive eating is really getting back to reconnecting with our own body in terms of deciding what to eat, when to eat, how much to eat without judgment, you know, really thinking about food and nutrition from a place of nourishment and self-care and nurturing rather than like the self-control or the restriction or the deprivation.
I feel like the definition can kind of feel daunting to some people because they're like, oh, listen to my body. Well, I don't even know how to do that anymore. So based on everyone's background of dieting, do you think that there's a type of person that intuitive eating is kind of best suited for?
In my mind, intuitive eating is really for everybody. Mm-hmm, I think, you know, if you're someone that has been dieting or has any kind of disordered eating at all, or, you know, eating disorder, the first thing you need to do, like foundationally, is making sure you're eating enough and eating consistently. And when I say eating enough, I mean both calories, but also carbohydrates, because that's usually something that people are not eating enough of. Yeah, a lot of people's hunger and satiety cues will atrophy over time if they've been ignoring their body cues or overriding them for a long time. And I think a lot of times people fear hunger, like hunger has become this like four-letter word of like, oh no, I don't want to be hungry. But in reality, hunger is like your body saying like, hey, I'm trying to keep you alive.
And Alissa really believes that this way of eating is for everyone. And I feel so happy to say that it's been working really well for me. Nowadays, I feel like I can eat and feel fully satisfied and just move on with my day without constantly thinking about food. My body now can clearly let me know when it starts to feel hungry and gives me very distinct cues for fullness. And it's crazy. I'll be eating a meal and it hits me like a smack in the face or the stomach or whatever. I'll take a bite and start feeling full and then maybe one or two more. And then my body is like, nope, girl, you are full.
Have some left. Save it for later. Full, but not bloated.
And I'll put down my fork and I'll be like, yep, I'm full. Unless, obviously, it's for dessert. Which is a really good feeling that my body knows so well. And I'm sure everyone's process will be totally different. I mean, like most people are not coming from an all-in diet and are more likely starting from a more restrictive diet. And that's actually also something I wanted to ask Alissa about.
So in terms of that process, you know, when I'm working with clients, before we start to try to like change any of their behaviors, really it's important to just like raise awareness. So if you're someone who is still macro tracking or calorie counting or dieting, just starting to bring more awareness to how that really affects you. Thinking back, you know, if this is something you've been doing on and off for a while, like what is your past history with that shown you? Usually the answers I get when I ask questions like these to people, they tell me like, oh, well, it worked for a little bit and then it was, you know, just kind of like off the rails, either like on and I'm like tracking everything, or it's like, well, screw it. And like, I'm falling off the wagon, because they only know these two binary things. But in reality, there's a middle ground. There's that gray area in between. And that's where intuitive eating is.
Do you have any other like other tips or tricks or even like mindset shifts for people who are trying to eat intuitively, but they're struggling like letting go of tracking or restriction or like fear foods, or they're struggling to let go of those things?
Start to do the opposite of like whatever your diet kind of brain says or your diet thought is. So let's say you're going out to lunch somewhere and you're like, the sandwich looks good, but like, no, I shouldn't get this sandwich because of the carbs. I should get a salad. It's like, okay, wait, you know, let me actually get the sandwich and see what happens. And so starting to challenge those thoughts and beliefs, and actually by like experimenting with it, which can be really scary, but we have to kind of like lean into that, because that's the only way we can challenge these thoughts and beliefs and behaviors, is by kind of doing the opposite.
So on that note, I want to offer a few of my tips or mentality shifts that I've used on my own quest of intuitive eating that has helped me so much during this process. So first of all, when it came to figuring out what to eat, I started simple. I just started with assembling meals that were balanced, i.e. protein, carbs, and fat. So my tip would be to resist the urge to cut out carbs. This seems to be a common issue, and a lot of women are usually usually tempted to cut them. And it's something Alissa also mentioned. I promise you'll feel so much more satisfied after the meal and not feel the desire to want to eat more food or feel hungry again, literally like 30 minutes later. Also, remember your body needs carbs, especially if you lost your period and you're trying to get it back. Eat the damn carbs. So tip number two, so you might be thinking to yourself, hey, I eat carbs, but you might only eat fruit or organic sweet potatoes. So my next tip would be to let go of the fear foods like pasta, pizza, donuts, and even sandwiches. Poor sandwiches always get such a bad rap. You probably don't regularly order one when you're out to lunch and might instead opt for the salad. But the reason this is a tip is because giving yourself this unconditional permission to eat these foods on a regular basis will actually prevent a lot of unnecessary binging and thus a lot of unnecessary food guilt. If you always give yourself that unconditional permission to eat, you can have a scoop of ice cream without the temptation to eat the whole pint, which might happen if you are restricting. Then of course follows the horrible feelings of food guilt and then back to restriction. It's a vicious cycle. I'm not saying these foods need to comprise your entire diet, just to remember to incorporate them regularly. There should be a balance of both health and, very importantly, taste satisfaction. Tip number three is more of a reminder, which might resonate with anyone who might be tempted to just altogether start restricting again. So something that might be helpful to remember, something that I constantly remind myself and used to remind myself, is that any form of restriction will take me back to the way things were before, dealing with extreme hunger and never feeling full. And trust me, I never want to go back there.
Let's do another bowl of cereal.
And not only do I not want my extreme hunger to come back, which of course happens when you're not eating enough, I don't want to decrease my healthy metabolism that I've taken so much time to correct. And to be honest with you, eating the combination of food for my health and taste leaves me feeling satisfied and also really helps my body get even more in tune with my satiety signals. Higher calorie foods, at least for me, are much more satisfying. My satiety cues kick in clearly while I'm eating, and they keep me satisfied longer, so I don't think about food literally right after I ate. Another perk is that when my satiety cues kick in on time, I never overeat. Like, I rarely feel overstuffed or bloated. My stomach is happier and my digestion is just so much better. And because I don't have clients or experience with working with clients, I also wanted to get some tips from my friend Deanna, who is a registered dietitian and has a ton of experience with working with women on their own intuitive eating journeys. Her first tip, which I think is great, is to stop weighing yourself. The scale doesn't measure our health or our self-worth. So she says that if you weigh yourself and you're upset, that stinks. If you weigh yourself and you're happy, that stinks too, because that means you're giving power to the scale. She recommends getting on the scale backwards at your doctor's appointments and asks that your weight not be discussed before lifestyle habits. And she also recommends getting an accountability partner to move your scale at home so you're not tempted. Her next tip is to avoid the temptation to hop on the next popular diet. She notes that intuitive eaters tend to have a stable weight over time that can allow your body to naturally settle into its set weight range. Chronic dieters who are constantly restricting will likely experience the opposite and make it really hard for your weight to stabilize, as it will always get stuck in like a weight gain and weight loss cycle. This actually tends to substantially decrease your metabolism, and people commonly regain the weight they lost and actually end up at an even higher set point. All reasons to avoid the newest trendy diet. Her third tip is more of a mentality shift, but she says to keep in mind that you will have bad body image days no matter what your body looks like. So she encourages finding body neutrality so bad body image days don't ruin your self-worth and you can move on. This can be much more powerful than finding body positivity at first. And finally, I want to leave you with my own personal mantra. It's very sophisticated. Just eat it. Whenever I'm feeling at all hesitant, I just tell myself, just eat it.
That's something good.
Eat the big piece of cake on your boyfriend's birthday without any guilt. Enjoy a movie night with your mom and eat pizza. Life is short. Don't miss out on the best parts. So that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful, and I would love to know how many of you are on a similar journey in the comments below. Like the video if you liked it, subscribe if you happen to be new, and I will see you in a video very soon. I love you guys. Bye. She better at filming than middle part, Stephanie? Okay, here we go, here we go, here we go. Middle part Stephanie sucks.